Hello everyone, welcome to Analog IAS Current Affairs Analysis for 13th February 2020 and these are the articles for the day. The first article for the day is taken from the Hindu and it is titled Nutrition and the Budget's Fine Print. So we all know that malnourishment is a huge problem which has various dimensions and it can affect the cognitive abilities of the workforce as well as young population. Now India, when it is moving towards demographic transition and when it is expecting to reap the demographic dividend, malnourishment is a huge challenge. According to the estimates of the World Bank, 16% of the world GDP is lost because of this malnourishment problem, and it is of particular importance in India because India has one of the highest number of malnourished kids in the world. Also, its performance on the global hunger index has been underwhelming, to say the least. So when we are talking about malnourishment problem, there are basically three facets. One is the calorie deficiency, the second one is the protein deficiency, and thirdly it is micronutrient deficiency. Now what do you understand by calorie deficiency? That is lack of enough amount of food. Now India has more or less overcome this problem, but it is the problem of protein efficiency in ensuring access to efficient sources of protein where bioavailability of protein is not a problem and where we can enhance the uptake of protein of the child to ensure proper growth. And secondly, it is a problem of micronutrients. Even in rich and affluent families, they are not aware of the implications of having a diet that is deficient in micronutrients. That is the reason why even malnourished kids include obese kids. However, the present schemes like ICDS tries to address this problem. But the problem is budgetary allocations. We have a lot of underutilization of funds in many areas. And overall, if we take a look at it, the funds are not simply sufficient for the efficient allocation of resources to ensure that this problem of malnourishment is dealt properly. Now, the government aims to increase protein access through introduction of pulses in midday meal schemes for the children. Similarly, with respect to micronutrients, it is trying to use the horticultural mission as a mechanism to address this problem. But for all this problem, the most important underlying theme is that the revenue implication for the government is not taken into the picture. These schemes are severely underfunded, and that is the central point of this article. However, the article also highlights certain positive impacts like the encouragement given to millets, which can have a multiplier effect because millets have better micronutrients compared to the normal wheat and rice, and this can impact a behavioral change across the rural sector where ICDS have huge penetration. One more problem with the Poshan Abhiyan, which is actually a scheme envisaged for convergence, is that nearly 75% of the revenue is spent for technological development rather than emphasizing on convergence. The convergence is the most important aspect where Poshan Abhiyan can see results. That is not being emphasized at this moment. Though it is quite understandable that initial days require more and more investment onto the technological part, the government must also balance out the outcomes as well, because without outcomes, most of the budgets will be utilized only on technology where human development is at stake. So, in order to address issues like this, public-private partnership should be encouraged. Recently, we have had the Women and Child Development Ministry coming out with what we call as the Bharatiya Poshan Krishi Kosh or the Nutrition Fund, which was established with collaboration from Melinda Gates Foundation to address the gap between access to food and agriculture. So this particular fund is utilizing the impact of agriculture or the scope of agriculture to change behavioral patterns of the society. Like for example, it is trying to push millets more and more into the public. So apart from already mentioned suggestions, one of the most explicit emphasis of this article was to allocate funds to agricultural based nutrition linked schemes. and ensure early distribution of funds and an optimum utilization of schemes under this. So what do you mean by this agricultural link schemes? Say for example, if a particular type of a crop addresses all these three problems, more and more encouragement should be given to such kind of local crops rather than a blanket scheme which only covers a few particular type of crops. So this requires more proactive approach from the government rather than a once planned and left alone to the ground level execution. That is the gist of this article. The next article for the day is taken from the Hindu and it is titled Riding on Data for Mobility. So in the present age, we are calling data as the new oil because it has a lot of scope for generating revenues. However, data can also solve social problems as proven by a case study in Hyderabad. So what is this case study about? A pilot case study proved that database governance can assist in reducing traffic or managing the traffic congestion better, and this is a case used by the present article writers to show how the next wave of transformation is based on digital governance. Now, what is the economic cost imposed by traffic congestion? A study proved that in USA, the cost goes to $87 billion, which is a huge amount. But if you take the case of Indian cities where traffic is mostly mismanaged, four cities itself have a staggering $24 billion implication. So if we can use data for managing our traffic better, we can save huge money. So it also proves the point that data is the new oil because data can save as well as produce money. So what are the basic essential elements of a smart traffic management system? So a smart traffic management system should ideally reduce congestion, reduce the travel time, should be based on facial recognition technology and CCTV cameras, should have automatic traffic counters, and overall improve the experience of driving, as well as it should have the ability to share real-time transit data. So when all these elements are combined, we have a case study in London which proved that nearly 130 billion euros worth productivity and efficiency have been triggered by employing database governance in traffic management. So that is also one more reason why India should approach this smart data-driven governance in traffic management. Hyderabad has the open transit data. So this is a portal launched by the Open Data Telangana platform, where portal is publishing data sets on bus stops, bus routes, and is trying to empower the startups and developers to create useful mobility applications. These data sets were built after an international exercise or an intensive exercise carried out by the State Transport Department, which also tried to collect and collate various data sets and verify and digitize this data as well. Hyderabad has been collaborating with the private sector to improve traffic infrastructure. The government also signed an MOU with Ola Mobility, a R&D center, where Ola Citizens is a tool which was developed by Ola to provide data-based insights that can monitor the quality of Hyderabad's roads and identify bad quality patches. So these kind of examples can also be incorporated in your answers to add value and to show that you are actually differing from the rest of the crowd. So please make a note of these kind of examples. So in our Smart Cities initiative, there is something called the Command and Control Center, where these initiatives can take a head start and we can build upon this kind of initiatives in the future as well. Recently, the government of Telangana has declared 2020 as the year of artificial intelligence. But for artificial intelligence to really take shape into actual real-time solutions for social problems, it should be based on data collection, which ensures the data sets are updated on a real-time. So that is the gist of this article. The next article for the day is taken from the Indian Express and it is titled A Missed Call. So before understanding this article, let us try to understand what is adjusted gross revenue. This is with respect to telecom sector. Now, recently, the Supreme Court upheld the order of Department of Telecom interpretation of the adjusted gross revenue definition. So, it was considered a huge blow for telecom service providers. The telecom sector, which is already under a lot of stress because of the competition from Jio, is facing another big revenue implication because of this order. As much as 1.4 lakh crores is the amount that is due to the government from the telecom sector. And many industry players and analysts have argued that the payout of the huge amount could be the final straw for the already distressed sector. Now, in this context, let us try to actually understand what is this adjusted gross revenue, and this article deals with the fact whether this assessment is fair or not, whether the telecom sector got its fair trial or whether its side was heard or not is discussed in this article. Now, let us begin. What is AGR? Now, AGR actually means it is a licensing fee given by the telecom sector for using the spectrum, and it is charged by the Department of Telecommunication. So, it is divided into spectrum usage charges and licensing fees, pegged anywhere between 3 to 5% and 8% respectively. So, this spectrum usage charges and licensing fee together forms the revenue for telecom department. Now, the usage charges for spectrum range anywhere between 3 to 5% of the revenue earned by the telecom sector, and the licensing fee is roughly 8%. So, together this forms the revenue for government. Now, why is this AGR important? The definition of AGR has been under litigation for nearly 14 years. That is the fact we have to understand. While telecom companies argued that it should comprise revenue from telecom services, the Department of Telecom stand is that even non-core telecom operations should come under this definition. This impacts the outgo from the pockets of the telecoms to the DOT as it is used to calculate the levies payable by operators. So, currently, telecom operators pay 8% of the AGR as license fee, while spectrum usage charges between 3 to 5% as already mentioned. So, why do telecos need to pay out large amounts? Telecom companies now owe the government not just the shortfall of AGR for the past 14 years, but also the interest, percentage interest on that amount, along with penalty and interest on the penalty. While the exact amount will need to shell out is not clear, at present the affidavit mentions that they have to shell out nearly 82,000 crores, which itself is a huge amount for the already stressed sector. Ever since the entry of private sector into the telecom industry, this sector has always been marred by misgovernance or opaque governance. We have had situations where internet revenue, which was charged less initially, was used to hide revenue from international calls and domestic calls, and it is shown as internet charges because they don't have to pay a lot of licensing fee. And this is not the only instance. Time and again, telecom operators have tried to manipulate with the existing rules. So, in what the trade pundits call it as karma coming to bite them back, we can say that this is, should not be the way a business should function in a country. This is an opportunity for the court to lay down procedures and not indulge in revenge seeking, because this impacts the future revenues as well as the health of the future of the telecom sector. So, there should not be an erosion of trust between public and private sector. That is one of the biggest point of contention for businesses today. So, in the present scheme of things, the Supreme Court should do well to understand the concerns raised by the telecom operators as well. That is the gist of this article.
The last article for the day is taken from the Live Mint, and it is titled, "We Need More Political Parties That Address Urban Aspirations." Now, the gist of this article can be summed up in a very simple manner. This is about the reason why Aam Aadmi Party was successful in Delhi and what are the lessons it offers for Indian polity. The central point here is, AAP was very successful in delivering results especially when it comes to health and education. This is because they had a very high source of revenues for the expenditure that they are incurring on health and education. If a state particularly delivers on health and education, it can get back to power. Apart from these, Aam Aadmi Party was also successful in ensuring affordable access to clean drinking water as well as electricity. These are considered some of the most basic services that should be delivered to the public. So when a particular government does this efficiently, it has been proven this time that they will definitely get back to power. That is the most important lesson. So what is the central theme behind this article? The theme is, in India, we have traditionally believed that India resides in villages. But if you follow the latest demographic trends, India is going to be predominantly urban. So we need parties that are more urban in character, that is, they address the needs of the urban population. They ensure that they deliver basic services properly. For this to happen, India should have a special kind of a system which allows direct election of mayors, or taxation should also be given priority, and urban local bodies should be empowered enough to ensure that they get enough taxation powers. If you take a look at the portfolio held by Shiv Sena in the trilateral coalition government formed in Maharashtra, Shiv Sena predominantly has its presence in Maharashtra, in Mumbai and Thane, some of the richest municipalities. Shiv Sena's dominance stems from the fact that they have control over Mumbai, which is an urban area, and that is the reason they withheld the urban development portfolio. So all this show that the future of our country lies in urban areas and not just rural areas. So we need more and more political parties that are urban in character. So we have to consider this direct election of mayors. We have to understand that there are multiple reasons for urban miseries, and one of the most underlying problems is the absence of a powerful, accountable leadership at the helm of the affairs in the city. And it is because of this reason, the most publicized urban governance reform that is demanded is directly elected mayor. It allows accountability and transparency to become a part of public discourse. The mayoral reform bill, or the private member bill, which tries to amend the constitution for strengthening local governments, was already introduced by MP Shashi Tharoor. At present, most Indian cities follow what we still call as the commissionerate system of municipal administration, which is a British legacy. So what is this commissionerate system? It is a system in which the state government appoints the commissioner who acts as the executive head of the city, while the mayor is largely ceremonial. So this is an anomaly. We actually want a directly elected head to take the responsibility for affairs in the city. That is not happening. Even after the passage of the 74th Constitutional Amendment Act, we still have urban local bodies only on the paper, but not actually realized in its true spirit. It did not prescribe the manner of election, tenure, or powers of mayors. That is, the 74th Amendment Act has not prescribed such mechanisms which will enforce the direct election of mayors. So we need to address this anomaly in our constitution. At present, only 6 states, Uttarakhand, Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, UP and Tamil Nadu, provide for mayors that are directly elected. So this is also important for prelims perspective, because if there is a statement which says that there are no urban local bodies which are headed by directly elected mayors in this country, it is a false statement. Note this point. There are 6 states which actually allows for direct election of mayors. So that is the gist of this article.